So this is it, Bradford City.
Here we are.
Football club. This is a nice day for Bradford, isn't it?
It's pretty decent. Not too bad. I was expecting it to be colder. It's a cheeky little stadium, though.
18,000 tickets. Go Bantams.
Yeah, man.
What's good to see you, man?
You too. Just pull up my trousers.
Here in this, this is a personal location. We're in Bradford. This is where you're from.
It is.
Why are we in this stadium in particular? Is there a reason? Did you ever come here? Have you ever been to games here?
Yeah, I used to come here when I was a kid, like with my granddad a bit. I had a season ticket, so it's quite a personal place just because of that. But it's just quite iconic, I think, of Bradford as well. Like, it's probably the biggest like grounds we've got. Like, it'd be pretty cool to do a gig here. Like,
you feel about it?
Yeah.
You feel about it?
If you could feel this, yeah, it'd be pretty sick.
So when you come back to a place like Bradford, you know, and you've got obviously so many memories, and you know, you're a young man, but the last sort of 5 years of your life have been this whirlwind of experience and travel and success. You know, how do you feel when you come back to a place like Bradford? How do the emotions make you feel?
I think it's massively important, like, for me that I come back here, like, quite frequently, because it just grounds me as a person and just reminds me of why I started doing what I did and started making music. And it was because of the influences that obviously surrounded me when I was here and just wanting to do something that was going to maybe get me out of here.
Yeah, I wondered that, because I think everybody who dreams of entertainment or success in any way, when you're in a town or a city, there's a healthy sense of aspiration, a dream of getting out.
And that's something that I feel every person should have, regardless of where they're from, do you know what I mean? And I feel like the more grounded that the places that they're from, the more grounded they will be as a person. And I don't know if that's just something that I've perceived myself over time, but that's just something that I've seen in people.
You're a tight family, don't you? I've read
yeah,
that.
Exactly. And I'm really close with my family, so I feel like that's something that is, you know, a driving force for me to, like, I don't know, like, kind of prove them right, that, you know, that's the right way to be and you should be a close-knit family, because it raises you the right way with the right morals and the right beliefs, I guess.
Yeah, I was sorry to hear about your grandma, man.
Yeah.
You know, but I do think that, you know, imagine if you'd been on a tour or doing something like that, and, you know, to have a chance to actually be here with your family during that moment.
Exactly. Well, my grandma got to see the peak of success in the band and everything. She was very proud, and she got to see and hear some of the songs that obviously I've been recording for this album. So she was a special woman. She was really cool, and she was always very vocal. I think the songs might have been a bit like provocative for her at some point.
Did she ever have a word?
Yeah, she said, like, maybe you can, like, take the swear word out in some of the songs and, like, use some nice words. But she's just like that. She was very vocal. But, she's a cool woman.
So, you know, we're sitting here in Bradford City Football Club on the eve of you releasing new music on your terms.
Mm-hmm.
For the first time.
Yeah.
The song's called Pillow Talk.
It is.
How you feeling?
Like a mix of emotions. I'm feeling excited. I'm feeling nervous. I'm feeling happy, I guess, because, like, I've finally got to do what I wanted to do. And, yeah, I don't even know how to explain it and put it into words. It's kind of just, like, waiting for Christmas. Mm. Like, when you have that, like, build-up of, like, butterflies in your stomach, the anxiety sort of feeling.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm just feeling a bit of everything at the minute.
Let's get some facts, because fans will be watching this and listening to this, and they'll be like, all right, you guys can get into the conversation at a later stage. Let's get some facts going on. So,
let's get comfortable.
Exactly. So Pillow Talk features on a forthcoming new album.
It does.
Is there a title?
Yes, there is.
What is it?
It is Mind of Mine.
Mind of Mine. How many songs?
I wrote, I'd say, 46. 47 song.
Yeah, it can pose a, you know, a good problem, that, because you can just keep going. I think the studio can be such a cocoon, especially probably in your circumstances, that to actually come out and finish something.
Exactly, but the thing with this album was, it wasn't even really like that, because we didn't even set it up in one studio and just go do everything in one studio. We basically tried to spread it out. When I was recording with Malay, we made a big part of the recording process to be that we would go to different places and record. So the first song that we recorded was in Vegas, and it's a song called Before. Mm-hmm. And it was just an idea that we got there, so that's why we wanted to record it.
Just in a hotel room there, or in a studio there.
And there was a studio in the hotel, luckily. So we just took advantage of that. And
perfect. I mean, go searching, right? And you got to go search for your sound and search for who you are, right?
Exactly.
So how many songs are going to be on this record, on this album? I mean, is it finished?
It is finished. There's obviously little bits and bats that I need to do on certain things just to make it sound great. But... the majority of it's there, and it's a crazy thing to even say that it's done. But I think there's going to be like 17, 18 songs on the album.
Wow, man, that's a strong debut record. That's a lot of material for fans. They'll be thrilled to hear that, mm-hmm. You know, a lot of songs. Predominantly working with Malay, who you know, is most notable for his work with Frank Ocean, but obviously has his own label and is across a lot of great projects.
Yeah, he's just an amazing person. Like, from the second I met him, I just knew he was kind of different, like, because he doesn't really look at music the way that like a normal producer does. So he looks into every instrument in like high detail, and he understands how to break it down. Like, he can get a screwdriver out and like unscrew a microphone and tell you what every single piece is inside of it.
That makes
like
sense, because he's a sound guy too. Like, when you hear his records, it's not necessarily the collection of sounds he's put together, it's the way each individual one sounds.
Yeah, exactly. He just smashed it.
Who else is on the record? Who else did you collaborate with that's going to make it, do you think?
I collaborated with, I don't know if you've heard of her, she's called Kalani.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we love Kalani, yeah, she's amazing.
She's sick, I love her. And she's obviously just about to debut her album and stuff. So, I reached out to her, played her a couple of the songs in LA, and she was really cool. She liked the music. So she got in the studio within a couple of days. She gave me a song back that she wanted me to do.
That's nice. I think that's the best way you can do it.
We just got it done straight away. And
creative trades.
It's really cool.
What were you looking for in people? What's the common thread for the people that you surrounded yourself to make this record? What was important to you when you sort of could tuck yourself away to make this album?
I think the main thing was just to prove that obviously I can sing and that I have vocal ability and that we weren't miming. just that I can hold my own, I guess, and write music and talk from my own perspective and explain where I'm coming from.
Yeah. That day that you went out and did that audition, because the people who are watching all over the world, I mean, One Direction fans will obviously know some people who are discovering you at this point musically because they like what they're going to hear. You know, X Factor is one of those talent shows that, along with things like Pop Idol and stuff, became a staple of what I would call Saturday night viewing. You know,
definitely.
Prime time viewing, something the whole family can watch. Your mum, she convinced you to go and audition.
She did, yeah. I obviously had watched that show, like, growing up, and always had my own, like, ambitions and...
You yelled in the TV like the rest of us,
like,
basically.
Like, I want to do it, I want to go on
it. I can do better than that.
Exactly, yeah. So I wanted to do it, and then I would, like, audition and get the papers, and they'd come through, and then I'd, like, say, nah, I'm not going to do it.
How many times did you do that?
I did that when I was 15.
Wow.
Because it was open that year to under 16.
Why did you not do it?
Just bottled it. I just didn't want to do it. I was just like, I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to get through. So what's the point?
So, wow, so it's a confidence issue.
Yeah.
Wow.
So when I was 16, they closed it again. So you had to be like 17, I think, again. Mm. So then I applied again when I was 17.
What did your mum say to you when she got you up in the morning? What was the motivation?
I think I was just trying to give her some sort of excuse, like, I'm tired, like, I'm just going to stay in bed or whatever. And she was like, but you're not going to know unless you go. So she just made me get up. She was like,
you know, there were signs that you were going to end up in this place early on. I mean, if you look at the timeline, if you look at the way things started, you know, you got through to that sort of knockout audition stage, and then famously you refused to kind of dance. I mean, that's literally like,
that's what I'm known for.
And to actually sort of say,
I just came out on X Factor and did that. Yeah, no, I don't know if that is... a reflection of, you know, the fact that I was gonna always rebel against the system.
Well, I wondered if subconsciously you felt uncomfortable in some respects, even in that environment then.
I guess just the whole dancing thing, like, for me, just wasn't a thing that I was ever interested in. I was just massively nervous to ever do that on a stage in front of people.
But on that day, you actually invented a new form of stadium performance, because refusing to dance, and then the rest of your bandmates aren't going to do like a four-man choreographed groove while you sort of stand in the back going, I'm not going to play ball. So strongest voice wins in that environment. You probably spoke for them. And now everybody that comes out on stadiums, they all just split up into five and entertain a corner of the stadium, which makes perfect sense.
Yeah, exactly.
Because why would you have five people standing up in a centralized area where...
No, nobody needs that.
So exactly. you're a trendsetter.
Yeah, we did that.
You're a loping, trendsetter.
I'll take that.
A casual trendsetter. It's an awkward thing to do, to put yourself in front of your peers, in front of strangers, to perform in that environment. And do you think back about that experience and think, like, how did I actually get through it? Because it doesn't seem like you.
I think the real thing that got me through it was not actually realizing what was going on, if you know what I'm saying. So it kind of just happened so fast that it just took off by itself, that we were just kind of catching up with it. That's what it felt like.
Chasing the rabbit
exactly.
the whole time.
Exactly. So it wasn't... there wasn't any real time to, you know, sit down and process anything and be like, is this what I want to do? Is, you know what I'm saying? And that's the real underlying issue. That's what it was for me. I just needed time to breathe. You go on that show with your own preconceptions and they're just going to blow you out of the water anyway and show you whatever they want and make you do whatever. So you just got to kind of go with the flow. And I was young. So I was like,
how old were you?
I was 17 at the time. So I'd just come out of school and it was much more exciting than sitting my exams. So.
Yeah, exactly. What a good opportunity.
And I ain't got no complaints.
I can imagine there must have been some good times, certainly before it went absolutely
insane.
It was like nitrous in those
exactly,
movies.
It just went.